This market town, like others in Oxfordshire, is on a blacklist. Weekend violence is becoming traditional, say the police. 31 serious public order incidents were recorded in Thames Valley last year. Mobs shatter Shire calm, says The Guardian. Drunk rural rowdies break thin blue line, says Today. As rowdiness replaces rustic charm in the public imagination, brass tacks goes in search of the Shire wars.
Deal of poverty or deprivation there. What you do find, too many young people with too much money in their pockets, too many pints inside them, too little self-discipline, and too little notion of any care and responsibility which they owe to others.
Locally, and it's also a very nostalgic visit for me because it was here in Wantage at the VC Gallery that I used to cut a dash on a Saturday night. at the Rock and Roll. And I'm very sorry to see that they've now knocked the VC Gallery down. And with that, I would like to declare the fete officially open. Thank you very much.
Money we earn for ourselves.
Yes.
Where do you spend it?
In the pub, save it.
Cars.
Pictures, whatever you want to spend it on.
Cars.
Do you ever behave badly, any of you, when you're drunk? Honestly. Do you swear or do you fall over the place?
Everybody swears.
Everybody gets rowdy once you've had a couple of drinks. Everybody does. And then you get other people that are not so rowdy and they think you're giving them hassles because you're drunk and then they come down on you. It's the same way anywhere you go, I would have thought.
Wantage is the same as any other town, village or city. You get a bit drunk, you're a bit merry, you may be loud in a pub or something, but I wouldn't say it was different from any other town at all.
You sort of shout, "Oi, Yob," over there, and you know him, don't you, really? You don't sort of, "Oh, look, there's some old granny that's going really abuse her," or whatever. It's usually people you know, so it stays in a group. I tend not to drink too much, of course. I think, though, that it isn't really that violent. It does tend to be hyped a bit, you know. There's not usually... I mean, it's not every day there's a fight going on, but there is, I mean, I have seen them.
Have you ever fought?
That... Me? No.
Have you ever fought, Gideon?
No, not really, no. I just stick clear of it. It's not worth it, really. You've got to hold on to your job, haven't you?
The situation is that almost every weekend, and sometimes during the week, we are getting a serious public disturbance in one of the towns. And the problem is, it could be in any town, and one of the new factors in the last year is that it's been in the small towns as opposed to the large towns.
People are concerned about going out at night to have a drink or go to a restaurant. They're likely to be abused by groups of youths and so on. And I, for one, don't like going to Farringdon or Wantage late in the evening. For those very reasons, that I feel that it isn't a nice place to be. The language is bad. It's very offensive to ordinary folks that are out going about their business quietly. And I think that the concern that I have is shared by a good many ordinary folks and by a number of my colleagues on the bench.
How much have you paid in fines?
Paid over £1,000 in fines, I could say, quite easily.
Over the last what?
3 years. And I hate paying courts money. I don't enjoy travel because it is expensive. I don't like being four hours journey away from my family. I hate it.
But you could walk away from trouble.
How could I? Someone's pushing me and punching me. It's easy to walk away. It's not.
If they go beyond accepting reason and the advice given for them to go home, then yes, arrests have got to be made because the officers have got to police the area subsequently. And I would say they couldn't appear to lose face.
Most of it are dispersed anyway, so...
Don't worry about that.
What's happened, well, what happens is a lot of people get their vehicles broken into here, and, you know, we're trying to prevent it. So if you can take as much with you as you can, and what you can't carry, if you can lock it in the boot.
All right, then I'll do that, yeah.
And try not to be away from the vehicle too long.
Okay.
All right.
Yeah, sure.
Okay. Right. Thanks. Have a nice walk anyway. Yeah, all right. Cheers. Okay.
When the police tell you to go home, a hooligan is someone who doesn't. A lot of people will take the hint and say, well, you know, I've had my good night and, you know, I'll go home. A lot of people, well, the hooligan people are the people who stay and just say, well,
look for trouble.
You know, get lost, policeman, and start, you know, lose an hassle and, you know, if you're prepared to go home, you're right. If you're prepared to stay and end up around the police station, well,
how much has that got to do with the amount you've had to drink? I mean, does it come a point at which you have the sense to go home?
You wouldn't say that at 9 o'clock in the morning, would you?
Have any of you ever been done for being drunk and disorderly, or...?
Nearly.
Yeah. It's been close. Yes, twice.
Well, sort of getting pushed down Mill Street in a shopping trolley and stuff like that. And not being violent or anything like that. Just drunk and disorderly.
Yeah,
we were just sort of topping off, weren't we?
Yeah, just topping the evening off. And he jumped in a trolley and we pushed him down. And the police coming down just hassled us. They just Oh, I mean, okay, you're not supposed to push trolleys down Mill Street, but...
1 o'clock in the morning.
There was no traffic, there was no cars down there, no harm was done. And they probably threatened to nick... They did threaten to nick us and put us in the cells for evening, but they just told us to off and go home.
Yeah, they're all hooligans around here.
Why do you say that?
They've got nothing better to do.
Yeah, there isn't. So that's why there they go out looking to occupy for a fight. Yeah.
Everybody thinks they're better than everybody else.
No, 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 yeah. You can't get out of the way. And when were you last a hooligan, as it were?
When was the last a hooligan? At Stonehenge, Monday and Tuesday.
What did you do?
What did I do? I got fighting with policemen and stuff like that.
Why?
Because I was drunk.
How much had you drunk?
A hell of a lot.
The trouble is, everybody knows everybody. So if there is a fight, then you know exactly who it was, what happened, and why it started. Because it's so small.
And everybody joins in.
Have you ever been in a fight?
No.
Well, who joined in then? What do you mean everybody joined in?
No, but I mean, well, like, take last Friday night. There was sort of like one small fight in the Swan, and suddenly and everybody
just
like, was fighting.
It's like a whirlwind, it just went
all around the pub.
And there's just so many pubs, everyone, every week, every weekend, the only thing to do is to go and get drunk. You ask any you know, that man over there, yeah? You ask that man over there, what do you do every week? What do you do every week, yeah? Get drunk,
he's
yeah?
He's the troublemaker. He is.
You get drunk, yeah?
Hooligans.
Were you ever a hooligan?
No, never.
Do you know about hooligans? I mean, do you know anybody who's rowdy?
Yeah.
What do they do?
What do? They go out for a laugh.
Do you ever think that boys might fight to impress you?
Yeah.
What's your reaction to that?
Stupid.
Yeah, I think that's all.
Everybody has. I think there is not many lads in here that can't say they've been in a scrap.
But they haven't been in a scrap.
They haven't been. I should think nearly everybody's been. I mean, here's a prime example. This sewer.
Best looking bloke in Wantage. Okay.
Right, so can I just ask you before you go, have you ever been in a fight at the square?
Many a times.
Why do you do it?
Why? It's drink, isn't it? And, he's quite, well, mainly it's his people from Farringdon. Farringdon town near Wantage. Well, right. Usually it's at the country club.
Yeah.
And they come over here looking for trouble, go out for a good night, and they just start on you, so...
But isn't, what, do you mean you fight with people from other towns?
Other towns, it's gangs more than anything. You get a gang in from another town, they have a few beers, and they try and pick fights with us. And
so who are the outsiders who come looking for trouble?
Farringdon, Didcot, our lads, just people like that.
The other villages. Why do you feel obliged to fight them if they come?
I mean, if one starts, anybody can stick up everybody else, isn't they? It's everybody's ground, isn't it?
It's our town. Why should they come in here and cause trouble? We're not going to sit there and let them hit us, are we?
Have you ever been arrested?
Yeah.
What happened?
I got fined £345.
For doing what?
Scratching a car, for which I did do, and I got the blame.
But it's because you're a marked man, you see. People know you're a troublemaker.
See, I've been in a couple of fights in Wantage, and because I've been in a couple of fights, I'm a marked man. I've marked people.
What do you mean you're a marked man? Who's marked you?
Well, the police do, don't they? They mark anybody. The police in Wantage, they're so hard on you. They arrest people for nothing. Honest Scott, excuse my language, but they arrest people for nothing.
That's a B.
Thank you.
How long have you been in Montage?
8 years.
Well, in the 8 years that you've been, would have things got worse? Are people rowdy or not?
No, no, it just fluctuates each week, you see.
How long have you been here?
Me, 13 years.
What do you think? Has it got worse, better, or what?
No, I don't think it's got worse, no. I think, you know, when I first came here, we used to have a dance hall and everything at the top of the Victoria Gallery, and there was always fights spilling out onto the streets then, so it hasn't changed at all, really.
I get the impression, though, that there are more young people around, is that?
No. No, it's much the same as always. The makeup is much the same.
Why are there so many people in that kind of 18 to 23-year-old age group so visible?
Well, they're the ones that have got the money, they come out to spend it. Saturday, Friday and Saturday evenings. That's the reason.
Did you ever feel you couldn't cope?
No. No.
There is no doubt in my mind at all that the level of vicious, unprovoked and unnecessary violence has escalated quite considerably and is associated with drunken, employed youngsters. And that is a fairly new phenomenon.
There is a terrible misconception in Britain today that problems of hooliganism and street crime and so forth are somehow new. They're not. They're part of a long, well-entrenched tradition in British life.
It's a kind of pattern that's monotonous in its regularity over many, many years. You see, this quaint idea that at some time in the distant past everything in rural England was quiet and calm and lovely, well, in my 30 years in Abingdon, that just isn't true. I can remember 25 years ago, I used to do some volunteer ambulance work. So I used to pick the bits up at 11 and 12 o'clock on a Saturday night. And the incidents in themselves were just as serious as the sort of incidents you see now.
You can't just stand in there like a kid stay to me, can you?
So what are you doing?
Well, you're going to have a punch up about it.
What do you fight with?
A fist. If you get out of a bottle, you get out of a bottle.
But I think a year's national service would be the thing for them. They couldn't make them soldiers in a year, but you could get they could learn a little discipline and self-respect.
A kick out of it, you know, it's something to do. There's nothing much else to do on a Sunday. Bank holiday money, what else can we do? So we smash it up.
Well, they nick you for nothing, don't they? They do, they nick you for nothing.
Actually, I'm a teddy boy, really. The old fashioned type.
Would you say that the present situation is rougher and more violent than it was in your day?
Oh no, not as rough, no.
Now I remember the Mods and Rockers in Brighton days back in the 60s, and they were disturbing incidents. But to some extent, they were not the same as the incidents now. I mean, just a few years ago, we had the problems in the inner cities, and everybody said, well, that's deprivation, that's an alienated group of society, that's people who've got a legitimate grievance. What we're seeing now is people who seem to have no respect for society, no respect for authority, the fact that it's the police is really incidental. They're certainly not disadvantaged because they're educated, they're in employment. They're just very drunk, and they just seem to turn all of their hostility onto those that represent society, the police.
These days, I think there's this pushing authority and trying to upset things generally, and I think what it is that somewhere along the line, someone hasn't taught their children to behave properly to other people. It's as simple as that. You really must behave properly to people. You must show courtesy. There's not enough courtesy in the world.
The civilized veneer on the British people is pretty thin. But the unprovoked and vicious violence is something that's new. When I look at these officers who've been injured in the last year, these are officers in every case where they have gone to a disturbance. They've been surrounded by youngsters who have kicked them when they're down, policewomen or policemen, brutally kicked them to the ground, kicked them on the ground and assaulted them. When they have gone in the small shire towns in ones and twos to respond to public calls for assistance, and the hostility has been turned on them.
The vast bulk of people hold quite a favourable view of the police in general. Of course, what then you say is, well, why then do people attack the police as they sometimes do? But again, you see, I mean, one's just got to say there is nothing at all new in that. In the late 1890s, early 1900s, late Victorian society, we hear so much about Victorian values, it's important to put this in a context. One in four of London's policemen were assaulted every year in the course of their duty. And one in ten of those men would be on the sick list for a fortnight or more.
Do you have a fight?
Only when we're provoked. What right has a policeman got to say, come on you lot, out of town? They've got no right, there's no law saying you've got to be off the streets at a certain time. They come out and they come on you lot, off, out the streets, get out of town. You won't go, they start pushing you about. They're not going to just take that, you just take that, and they're going to do it to you all the time, more and more. Then they start pushing you in the back, think they got the power to do it. Then you turn around, push them, you're Nick, you're arrested, you assaulted me. Can't win.
When we all got sentenced, they was all stood at their notebooks and they was making a big thing, saying, oh, we was abusive, we was swearing and everything else. But they was using just as bad language as what we was, and we was getting done for the offence. And they was swearing and everything else, calling us names, hitting us. So if they never had the uniforms on, I reckon that would just be sort of like two gangs fighting, swearing and fighting each other.
I mean, the police are, whether they realise it or not, holding an impossible balance between one man's entertainment and another one's misery. And you see, you'll get a youngster who's had a few to drink. He's not drunk, he's happy, he's had a good night out. He's leaving the pub with his friends. They may be singing, they're talking loudly. To them, they're not causing anybody a nuisance. But in a town centre, if there are residents who put their head down at 10:30 or 11 o'clock and are woken by this noise, which always sounds worse at night anyway, to them, that's a terrible public order problem. So the police have got to react to the phone calls from the resident saying, look, there's this awful trouble with this gang of 20 or 30 youths, and I'm sure they're going to break somebody's window in a minute. So they arrive on the scene to be met by an indignant group of youngsters who are saying, well, we're not doing anything, really. And if the policing is balanced, then that situation will be contained there. But you can see the potential for the thing to explode into something more serious.
Do you think that attitudes to the police have changed?
Youngsters?
Mm.
Yes, I do.
In what way?
Well, in a healthy way, in one sense, if the police would accept it, and that is that youngsters are not as prepared as I was when I was 15 and 16, simply to be told off or told to do something without questioning, or at least confining the objection to mumbling about it afterwards. If a youngster is stopped and questioned by a police officer, and he feels it's unjustified, he's likely to say so. And sometimes the police reaction to that doesn't help the situation.
Are you happy, Chief Constable, that the response is always the correct one, given that you can have a large group of youngsters who've had quite a lot to drink and who may sometimes have a genuine sense of grievance if they're told to move along or to do something that they actually feel they shouldn't be asked to do?
Every time we have a serious disturbance, we always ask ourselves those questions. But you cannot ignore the fact that those incidents occur and those incidents have to be dealt with. And in the overwhelming majority of occasions, the police officers are dealing with an impossible situation, and they are the ones who are getting assaulted.
I think the police could leave themselves out of a few things. I mean, they pick you up for petty things sometimes. I mean, just people standing in a group being exceptionally loud. I mean, okay, so that sounds really rowdy and everything, but they're not really causing any trouble, and they've all got to go to bed sometime, haven't they? I mean, there's other things around here that they could pick people up on. There's burglaries like anywhere else, isn't there? I mean, they're just wasting their time doing certain things. Admittedly, you've got to have a few people around, a few police around to keep an eye on things, but it's a bit unnecessary the amount they have sometimes. They do go over the top.
Yeah,
you can have sort of two or three riot vans and sort of five police cars and about 40 police on a Saturday night.
Have you seen that we have got a riot van?
Yeah, it's a permanent riot van here.
Why is it here, do you think?
Because every now and then you do get trouble, and also it stops people from causing trouble. Mm. You see a riot van, you think, well, I could get carted away in that, don't you?
Would it stop you if you were very drunk and wanted to?
Unless you're a complete head case, yeah.
Some people find it amusing just to get arrested and then go and tell my mates, oh, I was thrown in jail last night because I was drunk and such and such. And they think that's a big thing, but to the majority of the people, there's a police van, I don't particularly want to get any trouble, let's go home.
Years back, there's just as many troubles with rockers and mods and everything.
Yeah, I don't believe
it's just, it's just more on the media's view now. Everybody reads it in the papers, it just stands out, but it's not bad town.
The youth of the 80s isn't any different from the 50s and the 60s and the 70s.
In fact, centuries ago, it's always been a market town with a lot of pubs and a lot of drunk people who were thrown in prison by whoever.
A government which spends almost a full decade extolling the virtues of getting rich quick, of abandoning responsibility for other people's health and housing, of making a profit out of medical and community services, ought not to be surprised when some young men translate that philosophy into the belief that they've got the right to do whatever they choose on Saturday night as long as they pay for the damage afterwards.
There's a tendency from the right to blame permissiveness, the family and so on and so forth. And there's a tendency from the left to talk about, on the one hand, social deprivation, but also to say that capitalism creates individualism and acquisitiveness and I'm all right, Jack attitude. But what is quite perplexing is that people were saying that 20 years ago, and people were saying that 20 years before that, and in the interwar period, in the 20s and 30s, people were utterly convinced they were faced with a new problem, which was the result of the breakup of the family, the weakness of discipline in the schools and the courts and so forth. And looking back to Victorian England, although late Victorian England already was convinced it had a new problem for these same reasons, and in fact Victorian England gave it a name, which is hooliganism.